أفلا يتدبرون القرآن أم على قلوب أقفالها؟
نعم let's go through this quickly إن شاء الله. عمر, how did the Sahaba, how did they learn the Quran?
And they read by memorize 10 ayats each day. And then 10 ayats, they'll memorize, they'll learn, they'll understand the meaning, and then act upon it.
Okay. And as you guys can see in the pictures, a few narrations, few extra narrations have been added, but the main objective is still the same. But inshallah, when these get sent in the group, then you guys can read it. What tafsir should one start off with?
Tafsir al-Sa'di.
Why?
And it's concise, his expressions are clear and easy to understand, is one that the scholars have advised us to begin with, and it's got a lot of emphasis on the Tawheed al-Uluhiyyah, and there's a few difference of opinion not to confuse the students.
Very few. Not just Tawheed al-Uluhiyyah, all types of Tawheed. Tawheed in general. Okay. Is not changing. There we go. Okay, what are the three types of people when it comes to the Quran?
And the first one being negligent. Second one, moderate, and the third one being extreme.
The third one being extreme now. And okay, explain those who are negligent.
Those who are negligent, they have abandoned the Quran by not memorizing it, by not acting upon it, by not referring back to it, listening to it, or using it as a shifa to treat each other's sicknesses.
As a shifa with the hamza and awda'in, that becomes shafa'a. Intercession. Okay. And what's the ayah we mentioned from Surah Furqan?
وَقَالَ الرَّسُولُ يَا رَبِّ إِنَّ قَوْمِ اتَّخَذُوا هَذَا الْقُرْآنَ مَهْجُورًا.
Which means?
And the Prophet will come on Yawm al-Qiyamah and say that the people have abandoned the Quran. They have abandoned the Quran.
They have abandoned the Quran. Okay, those who are moderate, who are they?
And those who read, act upon it, memorize it, refer back to it, and use it as a shifa.
Users, ahsant. And those who go to extremes?
And those who they read and memorize it, but they do not act upon it.
Ahsant, ahsant. And then we mentioned a few other points. So I believe that was it, inshallah. Did we miss anything up? Okay, okay. Right. Okay, so as you can see on the now, inshallah, we're not going to start with this one. We're going to start from the first one. Right. So if you look at the context page, I've added a few extra things in here so that it is, it's more complete and it'll help us going through the tafsir of these surahs. So as you can see here, number 7, and number 8, these are two things that we have added. Number 7, the sources of tafsir. I mean, when you do tafsir, what are the sources? What do you go back to? What do you look at? Okay. And then number 8, the types of differences in tafsir. So sometimes you'll find one ayah, you'll find that this scholar said this scholar said that. What are these types of differences? Are they actually differences, or what are they? We're going to look into those, inshallah. And then number 16 also, some of the famous tafsir books. So tafsir, the plural of tafsir. We're going to look at some of the famous tafsir books. Okay. And I have a few of them with me as well, which I'm going to show, inshallah. I don't have all of them because half my other books are still in the boxes. I've not taken out the boxes yet. But the ones that I have taken out, I'll show you them. Bi-Iznillah. And I'm not going to mention every tafsir book. There might be one or two that I miss out. However, the main ones, inshallah, I'll try my best to mention the main one so that you're familiar with these tafsirs. When you hear them, you're familiar with them. So the first one is number 7, which is the sources of tafsir. Okay, so tafsir, when you do tafsir and you, unless you come across an ayah and you don't know what this ayah means, what is the best way of doing tafsir of that ayah? What's the best way of doing tafsir of that ayah? The best way is by using Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's own speech to explain his speech. Why? Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, it is his speech. He is the most knowledgeable regarding what he meant by that speech. So the first way of doing, the first source for tafsir is the Quran itself. And this is known as tafsirul Qur'ani bil Qur'an. And those who came to the Arabic lessons on the weekend, you've learned mudaf mudaf ilayya, tafsirul Qur'ani, the tafsir of the Qur'an bil Qur'an, with the Quran itself. So an example for that, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, I've not read it in English, but I'll translate it and the references are there. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he says, فَتَلَقَّى آدَمُ مِنْ رَبِّهِ كَلِمَاتٍ فَتَابَ عَلَيْهِ إِنَّهُ هُوَ التَّوَّابُ الرَّحِيمُ. That Adam alayhi salam, you know, after he ate from the tree, he, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you know, allowed him to say كَلِمَاتٍ, a number of words, فَتَابَ عَلَيْهِ. Okay, which allowed him to be forgiven. Innahu huwa at-tawwab ar-rahim. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forgiven. Verily, he is at-tawwab, the all-forgiving, the most merciful. Okay, right. Kalimatin. What these words? What are these words? How would somebody go about finding the meaning of these words? Okay, what did Adam alayhi salam say? What was the du'a that he made? So there's another, and this is in Surah Baqarah. So there's another ayah, this Surah Al-A'raf, in the beginning. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he says, قَالَا رَبَّنَا ظَلَمْنَا أَنفُسَنَا وَإِنْ لَمْ تَغْفِرْ لَنَا وَتَرْحَمْنَا لَنَكُونَنَّ مِنَ الْخَاسِرِينَ. This is the dua. قَالَا, Adam Hawadi both said, our Lord, we have wronged or oppressed ourselves. And if you do not forgive us and have mercy upon us, then we will definitely be from those who are the losers. Okay? So how did we learn that this is the dua that is meant by the first ayah in Surah Al-Baqarah with the tafsir of Qur'an bil Qur'an? We explain the Qur'an using the Qur'an itself. This is number one. The second source of tafsir is the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam. The sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam. And a proof for this is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he says in the Qur'an, وَأَنزَلْنَا إِلَيْكَ الذِّكْرَ لِتُبَيِّنَ لِلنَّاسِ مَا نُزِّلَ إِلَيْهِمْ وَلَعَلَّهُمْ يَتَفَكَّرُونَ. That we have sent down to you, Muhammad, the dhikr, meaning the Qur'an, لِتُبَيِّنَ لِلنَّاسِ, so that you may clarify it to the people, you may explain it to the people, مَا نُزِّلَ إِلَيْهِمْ, what has descended upon them, وَلَعَلَّهُمْ يَتَفَكَّرُونَ, so that they may ponder over it. So this is like, you know, many ayahs, but this is one of the clearest ayah to show that the Prophet ﷺ, his job was to explain the Quran. We can't fully understand the Quran except by going through the Sunnah and the Ahadith of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Now, fa'idah, which I just remembered, somebody may ask that, you know, if somebody asks you a question, did the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam explain the whole Quran? Did the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam do tafsir of the whole Quran? The answer is not a yes or no answer. The answer is, okay, there's some detail to this. It depends exactly what you mean. Because the tafsir of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam are of two types. The tafsir of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam are two types. The first type of tafsir of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam is through his actions. Through his actions. And the second is through his sayings. Okay? As for his sayings, then the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam did not explain every single ayah. The person did not say this ayah is this, and this ayah is that, and this ayah is that, and this ayah means that, and so on. Okay? The Prophet ﷺ did not do that. So if that's what the person means, then the answer is no, the Prophet ﷺ did not do tafsir with his sayings, with his speech of the whole Quran. However, if the person means, did the Prophet ﷺ do tafsir of the whole Quran with his actions, then yes, the Prophet ﷺ did the tafsir of the whole Quran through his actions. And examples of this are many. So for example, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he says, وَأَقِيمُ الصَّلَةِ, establish the prayer. Okay, how do we pray? That's the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, where he says, صَلُّوا كَمَا رَأَيْتُمُونِي أُصَلِّي, pray as you see me pray. And then that's how we take the actions of salah from the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Hajj, Prophet said, you know, Allah says in the Quran, وَلِلَّهِ عَلَى النَّاسِ حِجُّ الْبَيْتِ مَنِ اسْتَطَاعَ عَلَيْهِ سَبِيلًا. And in some riwayat, حَجُّ الْبَيْتِ مَنِ اسْتَطَاعَ عَلَيْهِ سَبِيلًا. It is obligatory upon the people to do pilgrimage or hajj of the house if they are able to. I mean, they're physically able to and they have the financially able to as well. Okay, how do we do hajj? The Prophet ﷺ said, خُذُوا عَنِّي مَنَاسِكَكُمْ. Take from me the way of doing hajj. And then the Prophet ﷺ did hajj. And that's how we learn the rulings of hajj. And Imam al-Suyuti, rahimahullah, he's got a book in the science of Ulum al-Qur'an, which is a bit more general than just tafsir. It looks at everything to do with the Qur'an, the qira'at, the way it's written, all of that. So, and it's one of the you know, the advanced books when it comes to Ulum al-Qur'an. At the end of the book, he has actually separated a separate chapter, and he has gathered all of the hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, where the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam explains the Qur'an through his speech. So remember, we said they were very little, the speech of the Prophet ﷺ regarding tafsir of the Quran. As-Suyuti rahimahullah, he came and he gathered all of them at the end of his book, Al-Itqan. So that was an extra faida. That was an extra faida. Right. What's an example of the Prophet ﷺ explaining the Quran through the Sunnah? And we've given examples of the actions. What about an example of a saying of the Prophet ﷺ? For example, last ayah of Surah Al-Fatiha. I've not put the ayah because everyone knows the ayah, and we're going to take the ayah also. So for example, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he says, غَيْرِ الْمَغْضُوبِ عَلَيْهِمْ وَلَا الضَّالِينَ. That make us from those who are غَيْرِ الْمَغْضُوبِ عَلَيْهِمْ وَلَا الضَّالِينَ. A guide is on a straight path, the path of those who you have bestowed your favor upon, not upon those who have earned your anger, nor those who have gone astray. الْمَغْضُوبِ عَلَيْهِمْ, those who have earned your anger, وَلَا الضَّالِينَ, those who have gone astray. Who is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala referring to? Al-Maghdubi alayhim, those who have earned Allah's anger. And who are the ones that have gone astray? Al-Dhaleen, those who have gone astray. The Prophet ﷺ said in the hadith himself, and we're going to mention the hadith next lesson. The Prophet ﷺ said, Al-Maghdubi alayhim, al-Yahud. Those who have earned Allah's anger, they are the Jews. Wal-Dhaleen, and those who have gone astray, al-Nasara, they are the Christians. So now we know this ayah, we know the meaning of the ayah. Who is this ayah referring to? And how, what source did we use? We use the sunnah and the hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So hopefully that's clear. These are the two. First, tafsir al-Qur'ani bil-Qur'an. Second, tafsir al-Qur'an bil-Sunnah. Right. Number three is saying of the Salaf. And obviously the first people that this includes are the Sahaba. And then the Tabi'een and their students also. For example, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in Surah Al-Rahman, وَالنَّجْمُ وَالشَّجَرُ يَسْجُدَانِ. The Najm and the Shajar, the stars and the trees, they both do sajda. So for example, in this ayah, there's ijma' by all of the salaf that al-shajar, the trees, the ones which this is referring to, is مَالَهُ سَاق. مَالَهُ سَاق. Now, how do you translate saq? Allahumma sta'an. So check this before a lesson. Saq, basically, like, do you call it a stem? Would you call it a stem? It has that, not just leaves or anything, but something that has a stem. Maybe if somebody knows a good translation, I'll put it in the chat and I can mention it. But the point being is that all of the salaf agreed upon this. So how do we know that this ayah means that? We took it from the sayings of the salaf. Saq, shin. Yeah, saq is shin. But the reason I changed it was because, can you really say plants have, or trees have shins? You know, you get the point that's being made. Maybe I should have checked. Khair. Can everyone please turn off the videos, by the way? I noticed a couple of people turning on the videos. Okay. Number four, the Arabic language. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, in many places in the Quran, he says that the Quran has been sent in the Arabic language. Okay, so from them is Salaf are the students of the companions, right? The Salaf are the companions and the students of the companions and their students. The Sahaba, Tabi'een, and Tabi'een. Okay, so Allah Ta'ala says in this ayah, I mean, even before this ayah, he says, وَإِنَّهُ لَتَنْزِيلُ رَبِّ الْعَالَمِينَ. That this Quran is something that has been descended from the Lord of all worlds. نَزَلَ بِهِ الرُّوحِ الْأَمِينَ. It's been descended and been brought down by Jibreel alayhi salam. عَلَىٰ قَلْبِكَ لِتَكُونَ مِنَ الْمُنذِرِينَ. Upon your heart of Muhammad, بِلِسَانٍ عَرَبِيٍّ مُبِينٍ. And it has been sent down in a clear Arabic language. That means for somebody to do tafsir of the Quran, he has to know the Arabic language. That's a condition of doing tafsir of the Quran. That one should has to know the Arabic language. Because so many things are built upon the Arabic language. The Arabic language is so vast that one of the conditions that the ulama, like Lajna Daima, they gave when it came to translating the Quran into other languages, one of the conditions they gave is that you can't say it's a word for word translation. Because you cannot find, I mean, Arabic language in general, you cannot find word for word translations. Never mind the Quran. Never mind the Quran. So for example, even those who are studying Medina Book 1 with me at the moment, right? Don't some words come and I say, it could mean this. And in some contexts, it could mean this. And this is Medina Book 1. This is the first book you're studying in Arabic. Never mind, you know, the high-level books. And the reason number 5 is reasons of revelation. You know, we talked about Asbab and Nuzul. You know, why was the ayah revealed? Who was it revealed to? What was the state of the person it was revealed? What was the question that was being asked? And so on. So all of this help you understand what the ayah is referring to. Okay, so these are 5 ways of the 5 sources of tafsir. Tafsir al-Qur'an bil-Qur'an, tafsir al-Qur'an bil-Sunnah, bi-aqwal al-Salaf, bil-lughat al-Arabiyah, wa bi-asbab al-Nuzul, or ahwal al-Nuzul, ma bi-yabimuh, general. So these are 5 sources when it comes to doing the tafsir of the Qur'an. Somebody, okay, trees that stand on trunks. Yeah, that would make more sense. They have you know, trunks. That would make more sense. Okay. Okay, right. The different types of tafsir, differences in tafsir, the different types of ikhtilaf when it comes to tafsir. When it comes to tafsir, and this is something which is mentioned by a number of ulama, there are 2 main types of differences when it comes to tafsir, and these differences can also be found in, you know, other than the science of tafsir. The first is known as ikhtilafu at-tanawwur, disagreement of variation. What does this mean? I've written it there. They all say the same thing, but with different wordings or examples. Meaning you'll find one ayah, Ibn Abbas will say one thing, Ibn Umar will say another thing, Qatada will say another thing, Mujahid will say another thing, Ibn Mas'ud will say another thing, radiallahu anhum ajma'in. So do we turn around and say, wait, they're all different, they said 5 different things? Say no. Okay, most of the time, as it says here, most of the differences occur in this. Most of the differences in tafsir are the first one. Okay, what does this mean? They all say the exact same thing, but with different wordings, and or sometimes with different characteristics, different descriptions. So for example, with the example, it make more sense. The straight path, we're going to take this in Surah 2 Al-Fatiha. Okay, subhanAllah, can you see Al-Maghdubi Alim came in the previous example, and Ihdina Surat Al-Mustaqim, the straight path came in this example. That's why as I was going through it, I was like, might as well mention it. What does a straight path mean? Okay, some have said it means the Quran, it means to follow the Quran. Some have said it means to follow the Sunnah of the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. Some have said it means to follow Islam. Okay, let's just take these 3. Follow the Quran, follow the Sunnah, follow Islam. They use 3 different wordings. But in reality, are they talking about 3 different things? Ah, they're all talking about the same thing. They're all talking about the same thing. Following the Quran means you follow the Sunnah. And by following the Sunnah, you follow the Quran. And by following the Quran and the Sunnah, you're following Islam. It's all the same thing. They've just used different words. Sometimes they'll give an example. So some, you know, and this happens to us as well. Don't think that why this happens. Sometimes if you hear something, just apply it to yourself and realize that, oh yeah, we do the same thing. Somebody may ask you meaning of an English word. What does this word mean? What does this concept mean? Instead of giving a definition, you'll say, all right, you know, when you go to the shop and you do this and you do that and this happens, that's what this word means. You've not given a definition, you've given an example. Understand? So all of this comes under this ikhtilaf at-tanawwur, disagreement of variation, where they all say the same thing, but it's just with different wordings, examples, characteristics, descriptions, but it's all referring to the same thing. Number 2, the second is ikhtilaf at-tadad, disagreement of contradiction. Okay, this is where you're not able to combine or reconcile between the 2 opinions, or if there are more than two. Okay, so they're saying 2 completely opposite things. 2 things doesn't necessarily have to be opposite, but you can't reconcile between the 2. So for example, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in Surah Al-Baqarah, وَالْمُطَلَّقَاتِ يَتَرَبَّصْنَ بِأَنفُسِهِنَّ ثَلَاثَةَ قُرُوبٍ, that those who have been divorced, they have to stay, the iddah has to be 3 quru. Okay, 3 quru. What does the word qara mean? Okay, now the word qara, there's been ikhtilaf upon this. I can't remember the two sahaba. Was it between Abu Bakr and Ibn Mas'ud radiallahu anhu? I think maybe them two. Ala kulli hal, even the sahaba differed on this. Some of the sahaba means al-tuhr means al-hayd. That tuhr here is referring to the menstrual cycle, the menstruation cycle. Okay, so a woman, when she has to wait 3 menstruation cycles after she be given talaq, so after that she can marry again. Whereas the other opinion is ala. The meaning of qar is a tuhr or al-athar. 3 cycles of her being pure. 3 cycles of her being pure. Now, in the whole grand scheme of things, there's not a big difference. It's all both going to be 3 or 4 months. However, there is a difference. So, for example, if we say 3 cycles of a woman being pure, it's with 3 full cycles, right? So if there's like 1 day left, then she's on a menstrual cycle. That cycle hasn't started yet. She has to wait. And then it starts. Whereas if you say 3 hayl, the 3 menstrual cycles, then as soon as the menstrual cycle starts, let's say the same example, it started 1 day after, it starts from there. So obviously, then there's that 1 week or 2 week difference between the two. Ala kulli hal, the point being, some of the ulama said it means tuhr when she's pure, and the other said when she's on her menstrual cycle, on her period. Okay, can you reconcile between the two? You can't. It's either this or it's that. Okay, so this is known as ikhtilaf at-tadad, disagreement of contradiction. And this type, as you can see at the bottom, is few, very few. It's only a number of ayat here and there. Okay, and this subhanAllah reminds me of the, it reminds me of the, I think, poetry of Ibn Abbas, where he says, كُلُّ الْعُلُومِ فِي الْقُرْآنِ لَكِنْ تَقَاصَرَ عَنْهُ أَفْهَامُ الرِّجَالِ. كُلُّ الْعُلُومِ فِي الْقُرْآنِ لَكِنْ تَقَاصَرَ عَنْهُ أَفْهَامُ الرِّجَالِ. That all of the sciences, all the knowledge, everything is in the Quran. But then why is it that we differ? Why is it that we don't know? لكن تقاصر عنه أفهام الرجال. That's due to our deficiency in our understandings. So anytime you see any differences, even if in the apparent you see that there's a difference, in reality there's no difference. There's no difference in the Quran. An ayah goes against the ayah or anything like that. In reality, there are no differences. The only reason we see as a difference and the reason we disagree is due to the deficiency in our understandings. Okay, so these are 2 things I wanted to add. The sources of tafsir, Quran, Sunnah, sayings of Salaf, Arabic language, and reasons of revelation. 2 types of differences, disagreement of variation, ikhtilaf al-tanawwu', and the second, disagreement of contradiction, which is ikhtilaf al-tadad. Right. Last thing I wanted to add, which is right at the end. Okay, and I did this after talking about which tafsir should one begin with. And we mentioned the reasons why we should start with tafsir al-Sa'di. However, us in this course, we will be sticking to the explanation of Sheikh Al-Usaymi, inshallah. I wanted to mention some of the famous tafsir books, some of the more famous ones, okay, that you'll hear a lot. So the first one is known as Tafsir al-Tabari. Tafsir al-Tabari. I'll show this to Instagram first. I think it's backwards for you guys, and I'll show it to Zoom now. By the way, my Ahmad, you're recording, right? I think I come really small in the corner, so on YouTube you won't be able to see it. Maybe I think if you click on my picture, you know what's on the PowerPoint becomes smaller, and my actual picture becomes bigger, so maybe they can see the book better. I don't know. Let me know in the chat if that works, Ahmad. Okay. But anyways, this is Tafsir al-Tabari. And inshallah, the ones I'm going to show you are the best prints, bi-ithnillah. This is print of Dar Alimu Al-Kutub. And this book, subhanAllah, 26, I try my best to bring the last volume so that I remember how many volumes they are. 26 volumes, subhanAllah. And if you look at the, it works, alhamdulillah, it works. Is it full in Arabic? Yeah, Tafsir al-Tabari is in Arabic. Tafsir al-Tabari is in Arabic. Somebody said, change it around. Radwan saying, you'll make a post. Khalas. Radwan, I'll send pictures of these books and you can make the post like you do and we can send them. But inshallah, they're here as well. What do you mean change it around? How do you want to change it around? It's just the camera. I think the camera, it makes it, it softs it around. I've seen this sometimes, you know, when you see people drinking, you're like, why is he drinking with his left hand? Like, this is my right hand, it's not my left hand. I like, the camera is back to front. Allah, I can't do anything about that. Okay, ala kulli hal, tafsir al-Tabari. Now, tafsir al-Tabari, if you notice, if you look, I've ordered all of these in terms of the death dates. So the first one is the one who died the earliest. So Imam al-Tabari, Abu Ja'far ibn Jarir al-Tabari, rahimahullah, he is actually known to be the first one who wrote a full tafsir on the Quran. Before that, there were, you know, tafsir here and there, a few ayat, or tafsir of certain ayat in their books. For example, Imam Bukhari, Tirmidhi has a lot. You know, they have the chapters of Kitab al-Tafsir, and then they bring all the hadith they have regarding tafsir. But that's not the full Quran. So the first one to mention it, or to write a book in the tafsir of the whole Quran, is Imam al-Tabari rahimahullah. Passed away in the year 310. Passed away in the year 310. And if you read some of the, you know, he was an imam from Ahl al-Sunnah also. He was very, very well knowledgeable. Some of the things which are really good about his book is that he brings a lot of narrations. Brings a lot of narrations. That's why this tahqiq, this print is good, because the muhaqqiq, Sheikh Abdullah Turki, he looks at those narrations and he says that which ones are authentic, which ones aren't. This, I'll be honest with you, it's not really for a beginner. However, it's like a reference that maybe you can go back to. It's a 26 volume book. Somebody may ask, have you read all 26 volumes? No, I haven't. But it's more of a reference that you'll go back to when you need to go to an ayah. And this is like the asl. Everybody who came after Imam al-Tabari bases it on this book. Even Ibn Kathir. Read Ibn Kathir, he'll say, Ibn Jarir said this, or Abu Ja'far said this. And he means al-Tabari. Okay? And he'll stick with that. And if Ibn Kathir disagrees, then he'll mention what his opinion is and why he thinks that. But everyone who came after it is عَيَالٌ عَنْ كِتَابِ al-Tabari. Everyone is relying upon the book of Imam al-Tabari. So he's really good when it comes to that, with a number of narrations. And also when it comes to different opinions and saying which one is the correct opinion or the strongest opinion according to him, he's very, very good when it comes to that. I really try to read his biography. He's got a number of good stories. There's one story, it's a famous story, we don't have time for it, but I'll just give ishara to it. It's called Muhammadun al-Arba', the four Muhammads. Okay, Muhammad ibn Jarir al-Tabari, that's his full name, Muhammad ibn Jarir al-Tabari. And he with him, there were four Muhammads, he was one of them. From the other three, famous Salaf, I can't remember exactly who right now, they were traveling and some, you know, it's a nice story, inshallah, you guys can go back to it. Another point to mention is that all of these names, by the way, if you see, I've written Tafsir al-Tabari, Tafsir al-Baghawi. The word Tafsir, for the Arabic students, Mudaf, Mudaf Ilay, all of them, okay? The word first was the Tafsir, the second is the name of the author. The second is the name of the author. That way it's easier to remember who the book is by. Like Tafsir Ibn Kathir, the Tafsir of Ibn Kathir. However, that's not the actual name of the books. That's just what is famous with, so that's easy. For example, Bukhari is not called Sahih Bukhari. That's like a nickname given to it. Actual name of the Jami' Sahih Musnad, it's a long name, okay? So the actual name of Tafsir al-Tabari is Jami' al-Bayan an Ta'wili Ay al-Quran. Jami' al-Bayan an Ta'wili Ay al-Quran. The comprehensive explanation on the Ta'wil. What it means Ta'wil, one of the meanings of Ta'wil, especially with the Salaf, it means Tafsir. Okay, and tafsir on the tafsir I is basically ayat on the ayat of the Quran. That's the actual name, but it's famous with tafsir al-Tabari, and if that's what you use to even speak to mashayikh, it's acceptable. That's the first one. The second one is tafsir al-Baghawi. Tafsir al-Baghawi. Tafsir al-Baghawi, subhanAllah, is the questions I'll answer at the end, inshallah. Tafsir al-Baghawi, subhanAllah, I don't have it with me. Alhamdulillah, I bought it just before coming back to England, but it's in one of the boxes, so I don't have it with me. However, again, this is an amazing tafsir. Al-Baghawi is also mentioned in Rasulullah Thalatha regarding the ayah of Hijrah. قال البغوي رحمه الله السبب نزول هذه الآية في المسلمين الذين بمكة لم يهاجروا نادهم الله باسم الإيمان. You guys can go back to the lesson regarding what that means. But he's known to be from the Imams of Sunnah, and also Imam in Tafsir. And I remember Sheikh Usaymi saying, if I'm not mistaken, that, you know, the ulama of Najd in the past, they had three tafsir which they would focus mainly upon. Tafsir al-Tabari, Tafsir ibn Kathir, and Tafsir al-Baghawi. عن تفسير البغوي. نعم. عن آية عن آي القرآن. ألف with the mad on top and say yeah and just say yeah. Okay, the next one is تفسير القرطبي. He's from القرطبي. Okay, the actual full name is الجامع لأحكام القرآن. It's a bit longer, but we'll leave it there. الجامع لأحكام القرآن. Okay, sometimes referred to as the تفسير القرطبي. And this is the print of مؤسسة الرسالة. And again, the one who published this, the editing of this was Abdullah Turki. Again, and he's very good when it comes to doing the tahqiq of books. And this is 24 volumes. 24. This is actually a very thin volume because it's the last one. It's just references and the context page. Not really much writing. But one thing he is very good with is when it comes to the fiqh rulings and the aqwal, he goes into depth regarding them. So if you ever want to do a bahth, an essay, a research regarding a fiqh masala of a tafsir of an ayah, you go back to tafsir al-Qurtubi. Okay. Let me show the. That's okay. Inshallah, the pictures will be sent in the groups also. And the ones that I don't have, I'll try to find pictures online. Right after Tafsir Ibn Kathir, and I showed you guys Tafsir Ibn Kathir last week. Okay. And Subhanallah, Tafsir Ibn Kathir. You know, let's try to connect it with today's lesson. One thing which he's very, very good at. It tafsir al-Qur'an with the Qur'an. Very, very good at it. And more so, tafsir al-Qur'an with sunnah. You'll find thousands of ahadith in his book. Okay, thousands of ahadith. And also it's good when it comes to mentioning the different aqwal. And it's you know, it's very good. It's more of an all-rounder book rather than specializing in one thing. But when it comes to tafsir al-Qur'an with the Qur'an and tafsir al-Qur'an with sunnah, it's very, very good. Okay, and so this is just, and this is a Dar Ibn Jawzi print. It's a new print. This is very good. There's also Dar Tayyiba print, which is very good. And the ulama also advises, but this just came out recently. The first print had mistakes. This is the second print. So alhamdulillah, it's really, really good and really, really advise it. Sometimes when I talk about prints, if you don't understand, don't worry. But I know there are some students of knowledge who are a bit high level that might be going to Medina, etc., or they might be traveling and they want to buy books. So this is for them, inshallah. But for you, for those that don't understand or can't read Arabic, at least know the names of the books and the general specialties of each book. And then we have Tafsir al-Jalalain. Now, Tafsir al-Jalalain, and those of the Ajrumiyyah will know why it's Tafsir al-Jalalain, because it's a Majrur, Al-Alain, not Jalalain. And those of Medina book, we've not taken it yet. But Jalalain basically means the two Jalals. The two Jalals. And this book, Subhanallah, again, it's in one of the boxes. Allah musta'an. Like in the two Jalals. Why is it called the two Jalals? Because there were two authors of this book. The first is Jalaluddin al-Mahalli. Jalaluddin al-Mahalli. And he was the teacher. He wrote Tafsir al-Quran from Surah Isra, the 15th juz, till Surah An-Nas. And then he passed away. Then Jalaluddin al-Suyuti, the famous Imam. The famous Imam al-Suyuti, he came along and he finished it off. And it's known to be one of the best tafsir for beginners. It's very, very concise. I think it's a bit smaller than tafsir al-Sa'di also. And it's very, very good. And also, you know, Suyuti was, you know, you can say a bit higher level when it came to knowledge. So you can find when Imam Suyuti, he had quite more ahadith, etc. Okay. The only problem is that they have a few issues when it comes to Asma al Sifat, etc. So this book is a very good book for a beginner. However, study with a teacher so they can point out these mistakes. However, this is something which is really recommended by the ulama, Tafsir al-Jalalain. Then we have number six, Tafsir al-Sa'di, or you can see Tafsir al-Sa'di. Now, subhanAllah, the one I have, this is the one volume one. Okay, one volume. It's a bit of a thick volume, but it's one volume. Okay, you can find it. This is Dar Ibn Jawzi print. Very good. It's also got the what you call Taqdeem, the preface by Ibn Uthaymeen, and also by Sheikh Abdullah Al-Aqil. Okay, so it's very, very good. I mean, let me show you how it looks from the inside. From inside, it looks like that. Okay, so as you can see, the page is there from the Mus'haf, and then the rest is the tafsir. Okay, let me show you guys. Okay, and We said Tafsir al-Sa'di, he's very good when it comes to being ikhtisar, summarizing. He does bring a lot of extra fawaid that you actually won't find in some of the other tafsir. You won't find in some of the big or long ones. Like he brings some fawaid. He focus, and we mentioned the reasons why. We mentioned the reasons why, and it's very, very recommended. There is another print by Dar ibn Jawzi themselves. As you can see, the writing is a bit, you know, close together. So there is another one which is 4 volume, which is really spaced out. Okay. As for last lesson, you know, in the Q&A, a lot of brothers asked that, you know, in English it's 10 volumes. I did a bit of research and I found that there's actually more than one print. There's some which are less than that. There's one which is 3 volumes and so on. As for exactly why did that print go to 10 volumes, I don't know. I'll have to look at it myself to actually find out why it's gone to 10 volumes, just like Tafsir ibn Kathir. But one thing to point out is that the English Tafsir ibn Kathir is not actually Tafsir ibn Kathir. It's a summary of Tafsir ibn Kathir. Because Ibn Kathir, there's two main summaries of it, one by Ahmed Shakir and one by Mubarak Furi. Ahmed Shakir is called Umdat Tafsir, and the one by Mubarak Furi is known as Al-Misbah al-Munir. Al-Misbah al-Munir, that's the one that's been translated. And what it means by summary is just, you know, when there's a lot of number of, let's say 10 ahadith, he just takes out all of them and leaves the authentic ones, which proves the point. When it comes to the whole chain of narration, takes out, just leaves the Sahabi, and so on, just things like that. So that's one reason why it's similar. But even then, why is it going all the way to 10? Allahu A'lam. Allahu A'lam. But yeah, this is Tafsir al-Sa'di. And this is the one which is recommended for beginners. And lastly, Tafsir al-Shanqiti. Now, Tafsir al-Shanqiti is actually over here somewhere. Oh, alhamdulillah, it's actually at the top. I can get that. Alright, Tafsir al-Shanqiti, this is known as Adwa al-Bayan. It's a longer name, I'll keep it to Adwa al-Bayan. That's what it's known as. That's what it's famous as. And this is how many volumes? 5? Yeah, no, 7. 7. No. 7 volumes. 7 volumes, okay? And, subhanAllah, no, I will mention the whole title for this one. This is known as Adwa al-Bayan fi Adwa, you know, enlightening. The clarification fi idahi, in explaining the al-Quran bil Quran, explain the Quran with the Quran. So one of the biggest specialties of this tafsir is doing the tafsir of the Quran with the Quran. And as many of the ulama say that he, you know, surpassed Ibn Kathir when it came to this. Okay, this aspect of tafsir of Quran bil Quran, he did a lot more than Ibn Kathir. Obviously, he's a lot later. You know, he passed away about 30 years ago, rahimahullah. He was from the greatest ulama of the previous century. Him and also Imam al-Sa'di. And also Ibn Ashur, who also has a tafsir as well. And Shanqiti, you know, he used to teach in the faculty of Quran in Islamic University of Medina. Now his son is also a teacher there and teacher in Masjid Nabawi. But yeah, this is... very good. And also when it comes to Usul al-Fiqh, he's very good when it came to Usul al-Fiqh. He's a teacher of Usul al-Fiqh in Islamic University of Medina. He actually did a summary of the book that we study, Road to Nazir, over 4 years in Medina University. He did a summary of it into one book. So when and you can tell that from his books, that when it came to Usul, he's very strong for that, or in that. So this is Adwa al-Bayan fi Idahi al-Qur'an bil-Qur'an, illuminating the explanation in clarification in explaining or in clarifying the Quran with the Quran. I mean, that's just a translation I've given top of my head. You won't probably find a translation like that. But the main name is Adwa al-Bayan, Adwa al-Bayan, or the tafsir of Sheikh Al-Amin al-Shanqiti. Al-Amin al-Shanqiti. So with this, we finished the tafsir. There are many of the tafsir. Somebody may, you know, like for example, you bought this. This is a new one that's come out recently, and this is the tafsir of Ibn Qayyim. It's called Bada'i' al-Tafsir, 3 volumes. However, it's not considered tafsir. It's not considered a tafsir book. It's not complete. What they've done here is that they've looked through all the books of Ibn Qayyim. Anytime he speaks about an ayah, they've put them all together here. Okay, but so it's not really fully complete. And similarly, they did the same with Shaykh al-Islam. And this is 7 volumes, I believe. 7 volumes. As Ibn Uthaymeen rahimahullah, who has amazing... Ibn Uthaymeen rahimahullah, who also has amazing tafsir, and you know, whenever I try to do a lecture or tafsir of something, I always go back to Ibn Uthaymeen. Okay, this is the tafsir of Juz Amma. He has a lot of tafsir, but again, it's incomplete. And he didn't sit down to write it. These are mostly taken from his lectures, from his speech, and it's been transcribed. And generally, Ibn Uthaymeen's books, the best print for Ibn Uthaymeen's book is the Mu'assasa of Ibn Uthaymeen, the company or the publishers of Ibn Uthaymeen himself. And you can normally tell that they've got this sign of books. Yeah, three books at the top, that sign. You can, that's how you normally tell from far. You can tell that that is Ibn Uthaymeen's books. And there's many others, but we'll stick to this, inshallah. So just to summarize the books, just to make it easy, some of the famous tafsir, Tafsir al-Tabari, which is the first one, the Baghawi, we have Qurtubi when it comes to the fiqh rulings, Ibn Kathir, Qur'an bil-Qur'an, Qur'an bil-Sunnah, Jalalain, Al-Sa'di, and Al-Shanqiti. And with that, we'll finish the lesson. We'll take a number of questions, inshallah. Wa sallallahu ala nabiyyina Muhammad. Why after Tafsir al-Tabari were more tafasir made? For a number of reasons. You know, one from them is that all the ulama, especially when it comes to Quran, they all want to participate in that, so that if they write a book, people read that book and they get the reward for it. Also, they may see that, you know, that's really long, so let me make a shorter one. Also, in there, they might think that, you know, there's so many narrations, not all authentic. Let me try to put only the authentic ones. They also may see that, okay, he's missed out a number of points. Okay, so let me add these other points. Or he's mentioned this opinion. That's his opinion. I don't fully agree with that opinion. So there's always, and you'll find this in many books. There's always, you know, every alim has his own way of looking at it. And they all think, you know, improvements can be made, or this might be more beneficial. So they do it. What's the meaning of the word juz? Juz means, the Quran is split into 30 juz. Okay, in Urdu they call it para or spara or para. It's basically the same thing. Juz means part in Arabic. So 30 parts. So for Amma itself and Surah An-Nas, that's one juz, and so on. How many tafsir books are there in total till now? Which is the most closest authentic? I don't know how many they are. The most authentic ones are the ones, inshallah, I have mentioned. Why is it said At-Tabari and not? It's At-Tabari or Ta. We don't say Al-Tabari. At-Tabari, that's the correct way of saying it. Okay, I mentioned there are two types of tafsir. When it comes to explaining the names and attributes of Allah, does that fall in the first one? When it comes to the, especially matters of Aqeedah, especially the usul, then there's no difference of opinion. If you do see words which are slightly different, then it would come on the first one. However, don't write that down, because I'm not sure if that's a correct way of saying it, especially when it comes to Aqeedah. However, there's no difference of opinion when it comes to Aqeedah amongst the Salaf. With Surah Al-Muhalli do Ansiyuti? So Muhalli did the second half of the Quran, Surah Isra to An-Nas. Ansiyuti came later, and then he did the first half. Can I clarify about the part of the trees that stand on trunks? So that's, what does it mean by a tree? Is it any type of tree that you see? They've all agreed, no, it has to be a tree that has a trunk. That's what a tree is, basically. So you may say, okay, what it says tree, but which one's exactly a certain type or what? There's ijma' that if it has a trunk, it enters. That's just an example, by the way. I want you guys to understand the concept and not necessarily that example. Are all these volumes to be read, or are they references? Depends on the book. The longer ones are generally references, the small ones you generally read. What is someone who says that you don't need to interpret the Quran with the Sahaba because the same Quran is revealed to us, the same is revealed to them? I mean, there's a number of refutations regarding that. From them, you say that, okay, is your level the same level of the Sahaba? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sent the Quran to them. And when they were told to do something, it was them first. We enter into as well the ayah, but they're the ones who entered upon it first. And they learned from the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam directly. And they knew Arabic language to a very high standard, so they understand the words. So whereas someone like me comes along now, can't speak Arabic properly, don't know the rulings of the religion, and try to tafsir the Quran, is it going to be the same? No. When someone does tafsir, should he always fulfill the five sources? The more sources you fill, the more closer you are to being correct. Who gathered the tafsir of Quran bis-sunnah, even the sunnah with the word, it was Asyuti. Asyuti, this one here, the one who wrote Jalalain. Can you show what the difference between Mufassal and Juz? Mufassal is, you know, with the Mufassal is from Surah Qaf to Surah An-Nas, and that's split into three types. Juz, the whole Quran is 30 Juz. Can you name a few Sahaba who and Tabi'in, Tabi'in, who are considered to be pioneers in Tafsir? I mean, this is something that I wanted to add, but I didn't, because it's not really going to be mentioned. But quickly, in Medina, there was Ibn Umar radiallahu anhu. In Mecca, there was Ibn Abbas. Okay, that is Madras Ibn Abbas. In Kufa, it was Ibn Mas'ud. From the students of Ibn Mas'ud, there was, you know, Qatada, Mujahid. No, Mujahid was Ibn Abbas. Allahumma sa'an. Wait, I've got. I was just reading it. Actually, success. I like the hadith of the Sahaba. Stick to them, inshallah. Maybe we can talk about the Madaris of the Sahaba. Maybe in the following book, because it has a bit of tafsir in the beginning in the following book. Who were the two Jalalain? So yeah, both of these, both of the names will be Jalaluddin. Jalaluddin al-Mahalli and Jalaluddin al-Siyuti. Jalaluddin al-Mahalli and Jalaluddin al-Siyuti. Okay, we'll stop here, inshaAllah. Subhanaka Allahumma wa hamdika ashhadu an la ilaha illa anta astaghfiruka wa atubu ilayk. Inshallah, ask in the...